A lot of people believe that women and men are just different. Women prefer to shop, and men to fish. Women like pink, and men like blue. These beliefs rely on ideas about different genes leading to different behaviors, or the influence of hormones causing these differences, making them hardwired. One of these beliefs is that women are naturally poorer at math and science than men. To test whether such claims that everybody knows are true actually are, scientists use a standardized process that generates evidence meeting rigorous criteria to be considered valid. The process is intended to limit the effects of bias and beliefs that might influence what we want to be true. Everyone is biased to some degree. Often these biases are unconscious. The scientific method helps limit the effects of these biases. There is evidence that men have better visuo-spatial reasoning ability than women, but that finding is not 100% consistent, as some studies have shown the reverse is true. Other studies have found women have better verbal ability than men, but those studies show only small differences. Consistent differences include aspects of physical strength, physical aggression, and sexual attitudes and behaviors. These differences may be due to real differences in brain structure and hormones between women and men, but the measured differences show large overlaps between the sexes, not two very separate groupings. Additionally, what causes these differences is unclear. Until relatively recently, the educational opportunities for women were much more restricted than those for men, and even today there are still fewer women in traditionally male occupations such as science and engineering, where math ability is necessary. Many studies in the mid-20th century showed large differences in math performance between girls and boys. Many people are convinced that it's an intrinsic difference and therefore cannot be changed, while others believe the differences seen are caused by environmental and social factors, which can be changed. One proposed cause for the observed differences in math performance is boys being better at learning on their own, which may be perceived sexual identity rather than a difference in learning strategy. Another proposal uses the real differences seen in brain structures to explain the differences in performance seen. But the evidence showing these anatomical differences also show that while women and men may use different methods of solving problems, they both can and do solve them, so performance ultimately should be the same. The perception that women cannot match men's performance can lead to employment disparities, where women are excluded from higher-paying, more prestigious jobs. An infamous example of this kind of belief comes from the then-president of Harvard University, Larry Summers. In 2005, at the National Bureau of Economic Research's conference on diversifying the science and engineering workforce, Summers explained why there are fewer tenured women professors in science and engineering at top institutions as, quote, different availability of aptitude at the high end, further asserting that there are genetic differences between the sexes leading to boys outperforming girls in math and science. It should be noted that these quotes were taken from the transcript of prepared remarks provided by Summers himself, as there has been some controversy about what he actually said at the presentation. Summers reiterated these common claims made about science and engineering participation and performance differences between women and men. The data being used to justify the claims are older data that don't control for the possible environmental differences. The biggest stumbling block in studying gender differences expressed by many researchers in the field isn't that those observed differences aren't real. It's that the magnitude of the differences and their actual causes are unknown, but many assume that the differences are large and intrinsic. To approach the pattern seen more scientifically, this video examines the available evidence in one area of perceived gender difference, math performance. First, we'll examine if the difference is real, and if yes, how big it is. In addition, we'll examine the claim that there is more variance at the high end of performance favoring more men with extraordinary ability in math. Traits are often measured, and then their distribution is graphed. Here, the trait's value is on the x-axis, and the number of individuals with that value is on the y-axis. This distribution is called normal, as there is a central peak at the average value, also called the mean, and the trait is symmetrical around that mean. The spread of the trait can be described as the variance. One thing to be clear on is what does different mean? The two trait curves here have different peaks, which represent the mean of whatever trait is being measured. So in this case, there is a real and large difference between the two groups shown, though there is overlap between the extremes. What about these two? Here, there is still a difference in means, but it is much smaller, and the degree of overlap is much larger. Depending on factors like sample size, this difference can be considered quite real, but it's by no means large. These last curves show no difference in means, but the spread does differ a good deal, so that the ends are different between the groups. The common claims assume that yes, there is a difference, and specifically male performance will be higher than female performance, and that male variance will also be greater than female variance. However, in science, we want to ensure we're protecting ourselves from bias, so the alternative hypotheses that no, there are no differences, must also be presented. One tool the mid-20th century studies did not have was a statistical method called meta-analysis, which can be used to identify differences across data collected in different studies and identify how big those differences are. Meta-analyses use effect size to measure how much of a difference there actually is. Effect size looks at the distance between the peaks, and it also controls for the spread of the peaks. Effect size calculations give a zero value when there's no measured difference, positive values when there's better male performance, and negative values when there's better female performance. By common convention, effect sizes greater than 0.2, either positive or negative, are considered real differences. Another measure, variance ratio, compares the spread of the trait's distribution to see if there are differences at the ends of the distribution. Variance ratio calculations give a value of 1 when the tails are equal. Values greater than 1 have higher male variability, and less than 1 have higher female variability. The next slides show various meta-analyses regarding math performance in chronological order. Hyde et al. In 1990 collected data from studies including over 3 million individuals in English-speaking countries. When all the data were pooled, the effect size was negative 0.05, which shows a very marginal difference in performance, and with female performance higher than male performance. Additional analyses showed age group mattered a great deal, with older male subjects increasingly outperforming female subjects. In 1995, Hedges and Nowell performed a meta-analysis of U.S. high schoolers in the U.S. and found effect sizes ranging from 0.03 to 0.26, and variance ratios between 1.05 to 1.20. This shows boys outperforming girls, as well as higher variability in the boys' scores. With the passing of No Child Left Behind in the U.S. in 2002, curricula across the country became more standardized, and also much more data were being collected. The National Assessment of Education Progress found an effect size of 0.07 by 2008. The study using the NAEP data was another ambitious meta-analysis from Hyde and Mertz in 2009 using only 21st century data. When pooling everything, effect size was measured at 0.012, and for 12th graders was only 0.06. The variance ratios calculated were between 1.11 and 1.21. A 2010 study of more international data showed effect sizes ranging from negative 0.01 to 0.11, depending on the test. Another 2010 study of international data found an overall effect size of 0.05 and a variance ratio of 1.07. A 2010 study of Lindberg et al. Also produced this histogram of effect sizes from the study included in their samples. Effect sizes between negative 0.02 to 0.04 were most common, which are well below that conventional 0.2 to be considered real. A similar plot of variance ratios shows that there is a skew towards greater male variability. Hyde and Mertz created a theoretical representation of their data using the effect size and variance ratios calculated to examine that high-end differences hypothesis more closely. This here is what Larry Summers was talking about. There is a real difference between variances in male and female performance, but that difference would produce about 2.15 men for every one woman if we assumed the maximum variance ratio seen. That difference is likely exaggerated, and it is also not representative of the number of men versus women in tenured positions at elite institutions, as Summers suggested. There are about 4 men for every one woman instead. So what are the answers to our questions? Are there differences in math performance depending on gender? These meta-analyses showed measured differences ranging from effect sizes of negative 0.05 to 0.32, but the overall trend is toward smaller values, especially less than 0.2, that value of effect size meaning there's a significant difference. In the US, the high school coursework chosen by girls is becoming more and more similar to what boys choose, including more advanced math and science courses, which may explain why the measured differences are getting smaller. Girls are simply learning more math. So yes, differences have been measured, but they are quite small, and they have been diminishing over time. While measures of variance do show boys' performance being more variable than girls, for the most part those differences are also small, though they have been measured less often. While there is more variance in male performance in math, there are still many examples of women who have extraordinary talent. Ada Lovelace is heralded as the developer of the first algorithm in the 19th century, and the world's first computer programmer, at a time when very few women were educated at all, much less in math. Grace Hopper invented the first compiler for computer code, which allowed for more complex programs to be developed. And in 2014, the first time since the award's inception in 1936, the Fields Medal, considered the Nobel Prize for Mathematics, was awarded to a woman, Mariam Mirzakhani. What are the implications of this research? For one thing, the widespread assumptions about gender differences may not be based in evidence. The arguments made about these differences often create stereotypes and implicit biases against both genders, and in the case of math performance, that women cannot perform at the same level as men. These stereotypes can cause individuals to have poorer performance than they would have otherwise. This is called stereotype threat and is a well-demonstrated phenomenon. Now that girls experience much of the same education in primary and secondary schools that boys do in the US, measured gender differences in math performance are essentially disappearing. What is different about the genders is boys are more likely to feel confident about their mathematical ability, and girls are more anxious about math. One thing is clear, though. Girls are not bad at math.